Okay. So, how much of you have heard of the term conversational commerce, or knows what's it about? You know? Okay, that's one. You too. Also, have you ever played with a bot on Messenger or Slack or something like that? No. Yes. Okay. So. So we'll be talking about conversational commerce. We'll be talking about the concept, and we'll be talking about what is making this concept grow and why is it such a big deal these days. Okay. So before I start, I would like to present myself. I am Rui Veloso. I'm now a solution architect at Sonai. I'm focused on the digital channels. Before Sonai, I worked for other companies. One of them was Microsoft for 5 years. I was a premier field engineer. I worked mostly on technical stuff, deep technical stuff, and helping customers achieve many and great things with technology. After that experience, I came to Sonai and I started, and I was for 2 years. I was working with the development teams. I was leading the development teams for the Continent Online site, e-commerce site. So, and right now I'm really focused on the architecture side of the e-commerce platforms. So, this is me. If you want to, you can scan this code. This is really a new feature on Facebook Messenger. We'll be talking about Facebook Messenger on this presentation. That's the Messenger app that I chose, but there are many others that are actually growing this concept. This is really because I really like these shirts and I never had a chance to show it. So. And my wife doesn't want me to wear it at home, so. What you saw there was a teaser, and it's an implementation of a conversational commerce scenario where Messenger is really used to buy or to call Uber cab and do all the shopping process for the Uber ride. Okay, so I've been talking about the conversational commerce and what is conversational commerce really. Conversational commerce is really a miscellaneous group of concepts that provide a service to a customer and interaction with a customer through a two-way communication. Usually, this is supported on natural language, and this is really a differentiator here. Many times, using voice or text, or even other kinds of stuff. So, for example, expressions or videos or messages, okay? So, this is also a concept that brands are very excited about. And that's because it allows each brand to stay in touch with each customer and it can provide a service on a one-to-one basis. Bots really come to provide and to increase this kind of interaction with customers. It is really proven that customers that interact on a one-to-one basis with the brands really are more happy with the brand, they create more engagement, and they are faithful to the brand. So bots are really what makes this possible and what helps these brands have the coverage and the way to interact with all these customers. What's really a chatbot? A chatbot is a piece of software, usually, that is able or has some kind of intelligence and is able to interact with the customer. It's able to provide several, like a service, or many times like a concierge that really interacts with the customer and helps the customer make the best choice, do a certain action, or reach a certain goal. Okay. So this kind of paradigm is really working in a two-way communication with bots, apps, and people-to-people communication. I will explain this in more detail ahead, but this bot and human, because what happens today is that people are using a lot of messaging apps and are really interacting with each other in a very natural way. Bots and humans can work together in order to create this kind of experience for the final customer. What this bot versus human harmony brings to the puzzle is that you don't know sometimes when you are interacting with a bot or with a person that represents a brand or a customer service or some kind of service that you are using. Okay, what really made this really special and really boom or explode? I haven't told you this, but Chris Messina, it was on the first slide. He's a development experience lead and on Uber, and he in San Francisco Bay. There are lots of people that are talking about conversational, that are talking about bots and everything around bots. This really is happening because of all these apps that we are using on our devices and are using on a daily basis. Do you know all the names of the of these chat applications that are here? There is one of them that you don't know. So from the top, that is Slack. We have been using this on the event. Slack is really, it has a lot of bots. It has a huge base of bots. Then we have Hangouts, Telegram, that's WhatsApp, then Skype. This is Viber. This is WeChat, and this is Facebook Messenger. WeChat is really a case study in Asia and in China. Right now, WeChat is allowing people in China and in Asia do everything that we usually do inside an app. There are brands like Burberry or like huge brands that are really interacting with users through these apps. And you can buy takeaway, you can call a taxi, you can send money. You can do everything inside this context, in the context of an app. It's really a big thing there. So these are the platforms that will really make conversational commerce possible. This next thing that I will talk to you about is really explains a little better why this is being huge and why in San Francisco everyone is talking about this, because there is all the major technology companies there and everyone is trying to know what to do with this kind of concept. Everything thinks that is the next big thing, because really right now messaging apps have surpassed the use of social networks. And this is P3 of 2015, and we are talking about 3 billion. So the 3 billion users using apps. This number should be higher right now. If we go and compare the messaging apps. This number probably is higher right now, the WhatsApp one. The Facebook Messenger has already surpassed the 1 billion users. And the statistics say that people right now don't install, some users don't install a single app during the each month. So people are really starting to use this kind of applications. And this is the right environment for bots and conversational commerce to grow. Another effect of this kind of usage of apps and concept is that it's starting to grow, or it's really influencing how we do commerce and our users behave on the web. Okay, so the important part here is the direct traffic. Our SEO analyst of our sites usually tells us that direct traffic comes from users that write www.continent.pt on their website. That's not entirely true, because direct traffic is also the links that I share with my friends on WhatsApp or on Facebook Messenger every day. And doing this kind of preparing this presentation, I went to my history and I really analyzed the traffic and how I am using the apps. And I saw that I share as much as 5 links with my wife of interesting articles or interesting products that I saw on the web. This raises another question, that is, most companies actually they use a budget for marketing, and usually they know that 50% of that budget has an effect. They don't know what part of the which 50% has an effect. And this will make things harder. So we need to really start grasping this concept and taking advantage of it and using it, because we are losing people that browse the web. And we don't know where they are coming from to our sites and to make purchases on our sites. So I've been talking about chatbots and messenger apps, and I would like to show you some examples of some bots. This is one really bad example of a bot that was created by Microsoft for Twitter. And Ty was really a teenager, was a millennial, that was supposed to interact with users on Twitter. They really made it intelligent, really, really intelligent. Now imagine one child growing in the worst possible environment, with the worst with the access to the worst kind of content, like, for example, people liking Nazis or anti-Semitic comments all day. So that's what happened with Ty. Once Ty appeared online, all the Twitter users went to talk with Ty and teach her bad things, really bad things. And she started to respond accordingly. For example, chill, I'm a nice person, I just hate everybody. And the ones that I really put the black spot on top was because it was really bad and I could not show you this kind of comments here. Or I thought I should not show you this. So Microsoft at some point took Thai and took it offline for several hours, or I don't know if it was hours or days. But when it came back, it was like a person on antidepressants. So they reduced the personality, or they built barriers around the personality of Tai, and people started not to find it really interesting, and then they took it offline. So With Facebook and the new platform of Facebook, we started having some kind of bots. Okay, they are not that intelligent, but they are able to interact with us. Bots are not something new right now. Okay, bots exist. I don't know. People in Portugal should know Anna from IKEA. It was really my first passion with a bot. I used to talk with her on the site. But bots exist as long as 50 years ago. There was one called Eliza that was very, very, very well known. These ones, really, what they take advantage of is the direct access to you and providing you with information. This is Poncho, the weather cat. This is one of the bots for Facebook Messenger. What it does is allows you to ask him questions about the weather and things like the pollen count in the air, so climateric air quality questions. And it has another nice feature that allows me to really subscribe to some updates, and it sends me, I chose to receive at 8 o'clock in the morning and 6 o'clock in the afternoon, the weathercast. And with the weathercast, it really brings some nice gifts that I usually have left in the morning. Another thing about this is that the other day, I've been using this for several months. The other day, this one really asked me if I really liked the gifts that he was sending me, and if it should continue to do so. I really did that. Yes, I would like to keep receiving them, but it shows that it's starting to interact with me, and it's trying to learn from what I do. Okay, from my behavior. Another one that is really almost a dumb bot. They call it a bot because it was made for Facebook for the conference, for the F8 conference, is the CNN one. The CNN one has the ability you can actually interact with them and ask for, subscribe some kind of alerts about news. And you can, for example, try to find news on the web. Let's say that I want news from CNN that have to do with NASA, okay? So it gives me some news with NASA and allows me to really scroll. If we have the time, I can show you these applications live, these bots live, okay? So this one really gives you summary of news. You can read the full story, and it gives you updates as the long all day long. So it gives you some updates on important news during the day. So this one is really, I really forgot the name about this one. It's Quartz. Quartz is a different kind of bot because it's a dedicated app, and it doesn't allow you to interact with them using natural language. So what it does is gives you some kind of information, and you can choose several options. That can happen with those ones also, but this one doesn't allow you to interact in any other way. And you, as you go and interact with them, it will get more precise on what you see and how it interacts with you. You can then jump to the news outside of the app, but it's really fast. It really creates a different experience from those ones because it's really fast and it's an in-app chat. Okay, so we can have about that. We can have in-app chats in-app. Okay, so we can have the several flavors. Another one that it's really important on the e-commerce side. This is me interacting with Skyscanner. And when I did this, I was scheduling my trip to Porto, okay? So what I did, I used Skyscanner to buy my ticket. This one is a bot that you can use it. You can open your Facebook and you can use it. So what it does, it drives me through an experience where I can, in the end, buy a ticket. It asks me from where I will be leaving, where I will be arriving, what date, and it's very flexible on the way you write the date and when you are going. I can say I will go to Lisbon tomorrow, and it will know that tomorrow is the 8th. It asked me from some preferences also, and it asked me when I am coming back, or if it is only one way, and in the end it gives me the different choices, and I can go and purchase that ticket. Okay, there is one similar to this one. KLM is doing this, but in a different way. For example, it's also a traveling one. KLM is using the Facebook Messenger to interact with the users. When you have a trip, imagine that you are going somewhere. You get updates about your ticket. You can get the boarding pass on the app. You can get flight updates. You can get a notification when the boarding is starting. So it's really, you don't have to install the application to really take advantage of that. This is one of the other example, where you go through the process of buying and delivering flowers. So you choose what kind of flower, where you want to deliver, when you want to deliver. And actually Facebook right now allows you to even pay inside Facebook. It's not available in Europe, but it's available in the US. So what we saw there, we usually use a lot of apps to do this. And there are apps that are built from scratch to build some kind of experience to the user. But right now, with this kind of paradigm, we can really build apps inside existing apps. For Facebook, for example, if you build some kind of bot like this, you have to go through an approval process like an app store, because they don't want your bot to spam users or only for marketing purposes. They want the bot to really have a nice experience. I think that this will evolve to be a more relaxed process, because I think the number of apps that we produce today will really decrease. The apps that will stay in the end will be the ones that really have a different experience and an immersive one. The other ones that we saw that are some kind of interaction, some kind of choice, some kind of interaction with backend systems from the brands, call centers, whatever, they will live very well inside these kind of apps. One other thing is that bots are no different from the personal assistants that we have. And we, like Siri or Cortana, and we talk with them with voice. These ones reduce really the attrition, because we can be on the subway or somewhere else and we are really doing something. There is another advantage of using this kind of platform, is that I can start doing something right now with the bot, continue tomorrow, and it's not really a person. If it was a person, it would be difficult to continue on the context. But I can be scheduling that trip when I have the chance to take my phone and select the next step. And that's really interesting. Another thing is that this is really about context, because when I am inside this kind of app, I really know, or this kind of bots, I really know the context. I don't have to install another application and register. Let's imagine a hotel. If I am talking with a bot from a hotel, from Hilton, for example, I think Hilton really has a bot. I remember reading about it. It knows that you have checked in on the hotel, and you can just ask for them to bring you some water to the room. You don't have to say the room, because you're talking with the Hilton bot. You didn't have to install the application from Hilton and really do login and for him to go to the backend systems of the Hilton platform and get the reservation status. So this is really an experience like Uber that will reduce the attrition of using apps, and using apps with context in the context of business. Okay, so this is the guy actually from Kik, that is also a huge platform, really thinks that this could be the next generation of internet. So, as a brand, and this is important for Sonai because we have digital channels, we have sites, we have brands, we have stores, we have customers, and we really are trying to take to leverage this kind of platform and this kind of new way to contact our customers and to give them a nice experience. So we would like to start and engage our customers. We have a bot challenge that we brought to PixelCab, and we are really creating the conditions to start using this. We think that we should start simple and then evolve. And starting simple is like starting one of those bots that really gives a streamlined experience, not like Thai, but or Thai, sorry, but like an experience where you lead the way to a customer in order to give them some value. We would like to probably try different approaches, like you can do this kind of stuff in-app, so I'm thinking about our Continent Online app. You can do shopping inside an app that we have. We could just put a bot in there and help our customer do some shopping. I'm imagining some kind of experience like, hi, and the bot would say hi, and I would say, I have a craving, and he would say, okay, what kind of craving? Salty, sweet? I would say, okay, sweet. And he would say to me, okay, on your last buy, you actually bought some Maltesers. Is that what you would want? Not Maltesers. You also bought a Lion chocolate. Okay, a Lion chocolate. Should I put it on your basket? Yes. So I just added a product to my basket inside my app. This can be done inside Messenger, inside Continent Online app, inside our own site. So we probably will start trying this in our several channels. The next one is really about bots versus humans again. We can see this being used to scale the way we do customer care with our customers. Usually you call a call center, you talk to an operator, and the operator really helps you through the process. We could do the first half of the interaction through a bot. Probably many of the questions people do to the call center really are things that we can predict and can help the user without going to the user. When someone really angry wants to speak with the operator, or the bot is not responding very well, or it got to the limit of the bot, we can actually put an operator to speak with the customer inside the app or inside Messenger, and really do a nice experience and help the customer that way through a long time or through a long period of time, and the customer will be interacting with us using that mean. So you also see some potential for targeting or using context or giving the customer the right choices. Isabel was talking on our talk about the Continente coupons. If some customer is trying to do a shopping on one of these apps, we can provide them a service and tell them that he has a coupon that he can use on one of his products that he's buying. So we can use context and we can personalize the experience for these users. If we go a little deeper on bots and frameworks, so this one is a list of really chatbot frameworks. And frameworks, I will be talking about frameworks, and in the next slide I will be talking about platforms. So frameworks are really what the building blocks to build a bot, okay? And there are several. The one from Facebook is the artificial intelligence part is built on wit.ai. This is artificial intelligence framework or company that they bought. and they are leveraging this kind of bot on top of this technology to include in Messenger and on the new framework they presented. API.ai, it's really a little more powerful than the wit.ai, and is very oriented to being embedded. And when we say embedded, is building some kind of site embedded component or app embedded component. It has some features for building bots that are virtual assistants, but is not very useful in scenarios of very complex bots like Thai, for example, that we were talking about. Microsoft Bot Framework, it's also a framework that allows you to build bots, but really the interesting part is Lewis, and Lewis is it's the cognitive services part of the framework. It allows to interpret sentiment or interpret intention about how the user is interacting with you, and you can find that the user is angry or is happy or is satisfied, or it really has a huge portion of cognitive services that allows to interpret what the customer is really saying to us. Viv.ai, so it's built on top of Siri technology. And the Aspect CXP and LU, this is really this is there because it all the frameworks that we see here, they work based on intents and entities, and that is a principle that allows the framework or the artificial intelligence to take decisions and based on the intentions and the actions. And this one really works a little different. It has a different approach to this kind of paradigm. So this is the next level of abstraction. This is really where a framework is something that is a building block and you will build your own bot. These ones are some of the platforms that allow you to build really fast, really quickly, and a nice bot. Okay, so Facebook bots for Messenger that is built on top of wit.ai and is really API oriented. The Microsoft bot platform that has Luis that I talked to you about and has another very interesting feature. That is the bot connector framework. So it has a lot of connectors for Slack and for all of those platforms that I showed you previously. Then you have, for example, InPerson, that is a platform where you can train and create a bot that has some kind of personality. For example, they have some examples, and one of them is me speaking, okay? And the robot me, it has a very nice interaction. You can go to the site. You just build your. It has a builder, a bot builder. Let's say you do the training of the bot. You do the questions. You identify your actions, and in the end, you can interact with your bot, and it learns from the principles that you gave them. And then in the end, you can just take that component and inject it in your site, and you have a bot on your site. It's really interesting. So, I will be talking about this is possible, and we can leverage these bots on top of Facebook platform. Facebook platform was Messenger platform was really launched in February, I think, in the F8 conference, and what they did was create all the mechanisms in order to take advantage of these frameworks, and build your own bots. Okay, so. These buttons that you see here, they are not by chance. They also created some snippets that you can put on your site and allow you to go inside Facebook Messenger when you click it on the context of a bot. They also created, when you try to search a contact on Facebook Messenger, they also create an area on the top that is bots and companies. So if you try to find a bot, it should be on bots and companies, and it aggregates that information. When I was in the process of finding some bots, sometimes I would go to a company and I would ask, oh, are you a bot? And they would say, no. And sometimes I would say, are you a bot? And the bot would say, hi, these are your options. And I would know that I was talking to a bot. I was not always sure, okay? So they also created some kind of accelerators. All that you saw on the examples I gave you, the CNN, for example, that you saw all those buttons and you could interact with each news, or the Skyscanner one where you had the option. So they created several templates that allow you to create a rich experience inside of Messenger that didn't exist to the date. So how is this supposed to work here? So usually you have your Facebook. I'm just using Facebook, but it's the same with all the ones, okay? All the other ones. So usually the user has a page or has Facebook, the Facebook Messenger app. They are connected to the Facebook servers that get the request, and then you enter bot world. And this cog, I will be talking to you about this in the next steps. But usually this is like a gateway to all other things. And all other things can be AI, can be backend services of companies, can be predictive models like the one that Isabel talked on our talk. So it really can be anything that exists out there. And the bot can articulate all these concepts. If we tried to build a bot for Facebook, what we had to do was really a nice simple steps. Okay, I will take you through them. I will have to create an app and a page. Okay, so the app on Facebook is a set of it's a group of settings that I will be using, and the page is really the visual representation of the bot, either on Messenger or on the browser, is the thing that we see, okay? Then we have to set up a webhook. So what we do is we just create an API, we put it somewhere, and we say, okay, this is my API, and we just go to Facebook, to the app on Facebook, and we say, this is my webhook, and then you have to respond to the webhook with a 200 status, so it knows that exists, and the webhook is created to your API. That is actually Node. So then you go to the app backend, and you generate a token. This token gives you access to this app for you to use on your interactions with this application. This page, when I was seeing this, it doesn't save the token, so it generates a new one when you go there. You should not see the one that you generated, but all the ones that you generated should be valid. So if you don't see it, it doesn't mean that it isn't there. Then you connect the page and the app. Okay, and you create a link between the page and the app, because the app already has the webhook, and then you connect the page with the app. And then this is really the code that will be interpreting the messages that the webhook will receive. Okay, so when the webhook is triggered by Facebook, because I interact on a page or on Messenger with a certain entity, What the webhook will do is, in this case, and this is the sample app for Facebook, will run this code, okay? And in this case, we are actually getting the text of the message, okay, and doing something with it, okay? And then in the end, we are really receiving post, and we call the receive message method. So this is all the events that we are expecting. And then when we receive one of them, we call the action, And in this case, the one that is highlighted is messaging event.message. So when we get that message, we will call the receive message event. So in this is very, let me see. Oh, I think it's not important, but it's in the end. So in this case, what we are doing, the receive message that we called on the other slide, is really calling this code. And when it goes to the switch, it will because it was a text message, it will default to the send text message. What will happen is that the send text message will do some validation and call the send API, and the send API will really create the message and respond back. So what we did here was like an echo, okay? So I have the webhook, I write something on Messenger or on the Facebook page, the Facebook Messenger page, and what it does, it goes through, goes to my bot detects that is a text message, and really what it does, it gets the message back to me. So it always responds what I say to them. So this is really a quick example of how you create the whole pipe, the whole piping system to be interacting with Facebook. After this, you can do whatever you want. Because you can actually go and start interacting with some other kind of messages. The one was really a text message, and this one is a rich message. And this is the one, so this is another example that is a rich message, and this is the code that handles this kind of postbacks, this kind of action. So this is one different kind of message, not a text message, and this is the code that will interpret that content and get it back to me. So you can interact with text and other kinds of content. So this is an example. This is an example of what could be a reference architecture for an e-commerce system, in our case, the e-commerce for Sonai. And I'll just go through the whole building blocks, and then I will explain it to you. So this is the conversation canvas. So it could be the platform for Facebook or for Skype or wherever. We have the custom apps, and the custom apps are the end user apps, okay? We have the cognitive services, and this part of cognitive services is for translating text into determining the what the user wants to do on the client app, okay? Then we go to the bot framework that has all those connectors, and this one is actually made for the Microsoft technology. Okay, that's just an example. It would work with any other bot. So you have the part with the connectors on the left, and you have the bot on the right. We have the intents. So this is Louis. This is really Louis that I showed you about. That is really interpreting what the customer is saying. It's determining what the customer wants to do. Going back to the cognitive services again to know what the customer is feeling, if he is angry, if he is happy, what he could want to do next. Then we are representing this. This is our public API. And when I'm talking about the public API, this could be a block here. Okay, so this really could be a block here. This one. It's like exploded, okay? So this could be a block here. It could be exposed like a capability. Then we have the backend systems. And then we have the enrichment services, like the recommendation service and all the other services that we can use to analyze events and take to give data to the system. So what we're seeing here is like the building blocks that could represent heading a bot to our system. We would have to have interaction, so sites and apps and everything. We would have to interact with the platforms. We'd have to have a building block that would be a bot technology or something to interact with the user. We would have to have some capabilities of cognitive services in order to analyze the intent of the user, and we would have to take action or to take information from the backend services or even other third-party services on the web. So this takes us to the next step. So Sonai is a company that, like many others, is not a startup that really grew last month or last year. And we have a huge amount of backend services that or systems that really where we leverage our business and our IT, okay? And the commerce platforms are really interacting with those systems in order, for example, when you do a purchase on the Continente site, the whole platform manages the all the process until the order gets to your home. So we have to use a lot of backend services, and we have to use a lot of capabilities from our architecture. What's really happening is that this kind of the mobile world and this kind of paradigms really are forcing us to expose more capabilities of our architecture in order to leverage this kind of capabilities. And we are not just using a site. We are any one of you can interact with the Continent Online API. There is a challenge for that, actually. What we are seeing is that we have to grow to our architecture to be more modular. And this is really a path that we are creating inside our company. We are actually trying to work oriented to the capability and not to the functionality. So what we're doing is when we have to, someone asks us for a functionality, we try to map that with a capability in order to create some value and in order to for everyone to be able to use that capability. So I believe that in a short while, every capability of our e-commerce platform will be able to be used by you in your bots or in your applications. So this is only to give you an example of what kind of challenges we have being evolving this kind of technology and exposing this kind of capabilities in order to integrate with this new commerce world.
If you work in marketing, you better start upping your game.
Because you haven't seen anything like us yet.
In just 10 years from now, we'll be buying and influencing buying
in ways that will confound you.
We won't just watch your ads.
We'll expect smart, tailored content
based on our social graphs.
Tailored for me.
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 And me.
We want to interact with it as we watch it, not just with touch,
but with voice, with gesture,
with intent. You better embed everything that is featured with additional information, social APIs, and e-commerce functionality.
And we mean everything.
Everything. Everything.
The car.
The skirt.
The hotel.
The app.
Because we expect to double tap on anything to get more information.
Don't worry. You'll offset the cost by on-selling any lead to those data aggregator type companies.
We'll spread it through our networks
and co-create with you.
And when we do buy, there are normally more of us than there are of you.
We can change your business
in one trade
as long as the deal is on.
Augmented reality
will be the new reality.
AR apps will almost function like special skills to help us navigate reality more effectively.
You wait and see what the iPhone of 2021 looks like.
The clue is in the name.
And you better get used to paying us.
Our browsing, influencing, and purchasing data
will make some of us pretty rich.
But don't overstep the mark, otherwise we'll block you.
Mass blocks kill brands overnight
and keep you up all night.
So if you work in marketing,
you better start upping your game.
Because you haven't seen anything like us yet.
So we are millennials, okay, but we are old news. These guys are Generation Z, and these guys are growing in this world that I described to you, that will happen in the next year. And we are trying, really trying to keep up with this kind of concept, and really be ready for these new customers that we'll have in a short while, that will be the new generation of customers that Sonai will have. So this is the hashtag for the challenge that we have on Pixel Camp. If you want to check the challenge, it's all about the bot. And if you want to participate, you just follow the link. So yeah, this concludes our so. Just a quick recap. So we talked about what conversational commerce is, the concept, what really leverages it, so the new platforms, the new chat platforms, how people are using them, and bots. We talked about the challenges that could bring in the new architectures that we are building, and what kind of capabilities we have to have, okay? So this was really a pleasure. If you have any questions, I'm available. You have a question? Yeah. Go ahead.
Hi. Yes. Thank you for the presentation. It was really interesting. We know that it was before predicted that 2016 is going to be the age of the year for the conversational commerce. It's probably for trends, but I'm not going to have a question about the challenge, but I just have a question, like, briefly about the itself conversational commerce, as long as I want to get some information on it. I want to ask, like, how conversational commerce will change a customer service forever? I mean, in your case.
Okay. It's really the one-to-one communication. It's really the personalized interaction. It's really the customer giving us the confidence to have a direct way to contact with them. I'm really sure that most brands, or there are many brands where I would like to have a direct contact. I can see, for example, Apple, or Burberry, or even Adidas. Adidas is really doing that on WhatsApp already. It's creating WhatsApp groups and WhatsApp communities in order to reach some kind of segmentation of their public, and their public can talk directly with them. So I really see the interaction and the relationship between brands and the end users to be a more strict one, and a more confidence-based one. So once you earn the confidence of your customer, it will be a faithful customer for life. So that's what you want. You want faithful customers that always come back to you to solve a problem or to solve a need, okay? Anyone else? Okay. So let's finish this. Thank you very much.